So my name is Jun Shin, and I'm a type designer and graphic designer based in Providence, Rhode Island. Fun fact, Rhode Island is the smallest state in the United States. It's all the way up there. And I work for Occupant Fonts, founded by Cyrus Highsmith, as mentioned. And we're a brand of Morisawa now, as of 2017. I'm really lucky to be working alongside these amazing people, Cyrus Highsmith himself, John Eskenazi, and Marie Otsuka, my colleagues and friends. So it's an honor for me to be here, first of all, but I heard Dynamic Font Day, and knowing that a lot of people will be talking about variable fonts and web typography and things like that, I decided that I won't. So instead, I'll share with you some of my past and ongoing projects that are not necessarily related to variable fonts, but hopefully carry the same kind of experimental spirit that surrounds the conversation around variable fonts. So type designer or not, I think most of you in this room understands the laborious nature of the work that type designers do. And a lot of you are familiar with this kind of marked up proofs, the proof process that we go through during the design process. I think it's so strange and wonderful that type designers care so much about such details and sometimes obscure things that escape most people. And I am glad and proud to be now one of them, but I wasn't always. I came to type design as a graphic designer, and being relatively new to the field, I often find myself being amazed by the kind of things that type designers do, like the mundane tasks, more so than, say, like a seasoned type designer, because things are taken for granted. So like this fresh voice coming into the field is able to see, no, actually what you guys do is really cool. So, which is how this project came about. Ithaca is a typeface that I had designed earlier, and Timeface, which you'll see, is its sequel. Through the sequel typeface, I wanted to highlight some of the mechanics of type design, what occurs. So for instance, I talk about the control characters. So for lowercase, it would be the N, the O, and the P. And because the N, you know, you spend a good amount of time just crafting that N, because it carries a lot of the DNA that is then carried throughout the entire typeface. So that's why it's so fat. And lowercase letters tend to be blacker in timeface than the uppercase letters because they take more time. So basically, this is a typeface as an infographic of my time investment into each glyph. So plot time on one axis and weight on the other, and you see I, and then the E, or the Y, which took more time than the I, and then the E, which took more time than the Y, and so on and so forth. So it's a typeface about another typeface, basically. And another thing that I highlight here is how we copy and paste a lot, use the same form, and modify it to get another. So N is used for the H and other letters. And some of these letters, letter pairs that share integral parts, I show. And serifs are, of course, really fat because, you know, it takes time to arrive at the final form that you're happy with. And contrary to what many people believe, you know, ball terminals are not just circles. They also take a lot of time, and you have to customize it to each letter that it is then integrated into. Type is a beautiful group of letters, not a group of beautiful letters. Matthew Cutter is known to have said, but when I asked him, he didn't remember ever saying that. But he agrees with the idea, so it's still a valid concept. So this is a little book I made with the conceptual typeface timeface. And these are basically what you just saw in a book form. This was a great project for me because I was just getting into type design and learning the craft, and this project allowed me to kind of combine my knowledge and skills in both fields. So I'm going to share a story that Matthew Carter told me, because Matthew Carter is always a good idea, right? So this story was actually shared by Robert Bringhurst over dinner. And it's actually about the French writer, I'm going to butcher it, but Gustave Flaubert. Sorry for that. Known for Madame Bovary. So the story goes, someone asked Flaubert, "Did you have a good day at work?" "Yes, a very good day. What did you do?" "In the morning, I changed a comma to a semicolon. And in the afternoon, I changed it back." "That was a good day?" "Yeah, absolutely." And Robert Bringhurst said he's had many Flaubert days like that. And Matthew thinks that type designers also go through a lot of Flaubert days, and I totally agree. So, let's see here. Sometimes moving that node over one or two units, or that off-curve point over one unit, does make a difference. And in a pixel type like this, it can make or break it. So details, details, it fails. So in this next video, you'll watch me move a pixel physically with great effort. Ugh. It's hard. Come back with coveralls on, put my hair up. So this video highlights and celebrates the immense labor that all designers dedicate to their work. And I created it using an especially labor-intensive production method that is stop-motion animation. So it required me to work with 400 wooden cubes, prepare them, stain them, compose them into some kind of lettering. This was one of my earlier lettering versions, and I felt that for a video that's talking about the significance of detail, it felt a little bit lacking in detail. So as you saw, this was the final version that I worked with. It's obviously got flourishes, tails, some ligatures, and even different line weights. Which leads me to dog. This little cute guy is here to introduce to you the concept of anagram. Anagram is a word that is formed by rearranging the letters of another word. So dog would be an anagram of God. Darn, dump lot, whatever that may mean, this is my interpretation, is an anagram of Donald Trump. So with his presidency, the immigration issues kind of came to the foreground in the US politics and started affecting the lives of many in the worst possible ways. These are the sample walls. So building a wall along the US-Mexico border has been his passion project. And in a kind of like quick, immediate reaction against it, I created this anagram poster. So I'll come back to it. As type designers, we care a lot about the spaces between letters. And I think the space glyph itself is pretty important to us because we have it's a real glyph that exists in every typeface that you actually have to assign a specific width to. You have to consider how big your space glyph is going to be in your typeface. So I think it feels almost more tangible to type designers. So working with the space, what I did to create the poster was move it over to the left once, twice, until I got to another phrase, now all. So this was the final poster, going from no wall to now all. And I really liked where I ended up at, the now all phrase, because it embodies the kind of sense of urgency and inclusiveness that I think we all need, particularly in the US, but you know, universally right now. So going back to the pixel type, so I just talked about shifting meanings and how anagram can be a device of doing that. And my next project does the same thing, but also shifts points of view quite literally, as you will see shortly. When I was teaching typography, I had my students create three letters in the alphabet using different grids. So I'm gonna share with you just a few. So this was a Y on a 6x6 grid, a U on the 8x8, and an F on the 24x24. Ambitious kid. So what I did was I just put everything together into one font, and I prioritized readability over anything because it was already so messy because of the different grids involved. So already a different resolution, a varying resolution. So I made the X height consistent so that it's actually readable. And it was kind of just a gift to my students for being such great students. So this is me fooling around with pixel type. I think it's, as a type designer, you like do this at one point in your career, just for fun or professionally. But I was using the 5x5 grid and combined that with these kind of ridiculous sketches I was doing of dual-faced letters. You get this kind of thing. So it's a Y and a U in one form. An R and an S. And like in the Details Matter video, I built the actual letters with balsa wood. I like to work with my hands, if you haven't noticed. So it goes from Val to Gem. Gem, they're both my friends' names. So it requires that the user or the viewer kind of literally shift in position to read what the word says, or shift the letters. The angles are really important here. I like to joke that this is my version of wood type, because it is wood. So then I brought it back to the digital realm and made kind of like a web specimen page for it, and you can see the whole character set. These I built in SketchUp, but then I also made a 2D font, which you'll see. What this allows you to do is type cryptic messages that can be deciphered only by those who have the font installed. But one of the considerations here for me was like how to pair the two letters, because they weren't entirely random. Most of them were formal decisions to be made, but I made sure that the vowels ended up together so that even when you switched cases and got something cryptic, you could still read it, because it still had the resemblance of some kind of Latin-based language. So hello becomes whammy, rather than just a jumble of consonants that you couldn't even begin to pronounce. So this kind of translation between 2D and 3D and analog and digital spaces continues to be one of my interests. And in this next project, I asked people to turn themselves into digital tools. So this is a common design environment that we encounter, namely Adobe Illustrator, and this is the analog version that we created.
Open Illustrator. Create new document. Create a 8x10 foot artboard. Cursor, select a rectangle. Rectangle, select red. Rectangle and red. Draw a 30x40 inch rectangle. Return to the toolbox.
Cursor, I'm the cursor, by the
select
way.
Select a circle. Circle. Draw a 30-inch circle. Return to the toolbox. Cursor. Select live paint bucket. Live paint bucket. Select blue. Blue and live paint bucket. Color the circle blue. Cursor. Select pencil. Pencil. Draw a wavy 4-foot line. Cursor. Select paintbrush. Paintbrush. Draw a wavy 4-foot line. Cursor. Select line. Line. Draw a 5-foot line. Cursor. Select stroke. Stroke. Make that line dashed. Cursor. Select drop shadow. Drop shadow. Make a 45% shadow. Offset 2 inches on X and Y on the circle. Cursor. Select stylize. Stylize. Make all 4 corners on the rectangle rounded. Cursor. Select rotate. Rotate. Move the heavy line by 36.7 degrees. Cursor. Select type. Type. Write Illustrator 101 in 400 point Myriad Pro. Command Z. 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 Shift Command Z.
Thank you. So by asking people to actually physically act out the role that these digital tools play, these tools that we use at the that are available at the click of a mouse, we ask them to basically consider what kind of tools are you using as designers on a daily basis, because we use them without really thinking about them ever. So in a similar spirit, at this point I was hooked on making other people do the work. So I collaborated with 2 other friends on another workshop that required people to make the work. We call this a beautiful script, a nod to the many meanings of the word script. So script can mean an alphabet, a handwriting, or an automated series of actions or instructions that are carried out in a specific order. So like, for example, a Python script used in type design. So English is always the language to be used whenever people from different regions, different nations are gathered. Like at this conference, everybody's speaking, presenting in English, right? So in this workshop, I wanted to highlight the diverse lingual backgrounds of my workshop participants. So 7 languages were covered here: English, Korean, Chinese, Japanese, French, Arabic, and Turkish. So what we did was this phrase, we come from different places and speak different languages, we make one beautiful script. We played an audio of each of these words in a different language every time, and we went through this 3 times. And, you know, just gave them very basic instructions and watched what happened. The instruction was just to listen to the audio and write down what you hear.
We
you'll see that
come from.
Some people wrote we in Korean, and you see the English we, and some were in French.
不同.
This is a Chinese word that's being written in Korean again, and in Chinese. So we went on like this for 3 rounds.
Différent.
Look at that guy shake his head. Don't know. So this was the end outcome, and this was a very scary workshop for me because I had always been a perfectionist. Now I like to say I'm a recovering perfectionist. And this involved a certain degree of unpredictability. I didn't really know if people would actually follow the instructions. I didn't know what the end outcome might look like. I didn't know it was going to be so messy. I thought I would get like neat lines of, you know, words in different languages so that in the end you would be able to actually get the phrases that we started with. But this is what we ended up with. But this through this project, I kind of became open to the idea of letting in chance and collaboration with others. Letting go of some of that control that I really loved so much. So this is another project where I asked people to do the work. So by sharing a childhood memory of my childhood home that I had and asking them to paint something for me, so let me read one. Please paint an arched staircase curving up toward the top right corner of this panel. And before that is the piece of memory that I shared about the staircase. So they each got a different prompt and started painting. And as they were finishing up, I would grab the panel and start arranging them and hanging them. And by the end, that's me performing the thing. And by the end, you ended up with the word home. Can be hard to read, but that's the nature of involving other people in your project and the end outcome of your project. So, you know, growing up as an immigrant in the United States, I never felt like I was quite home. And it was when I got to the Rhode Island School of Design where I went for my master's in graphic design that I met really like-minded people who cared about the same things that I did and created this community and a sense of belonging for me. So by performing this, it was kind of like a love letter from me to my creative community saying thank you for creating this safe environment where I can explore. All right, so speaking of instructions, some of you may know, in 1975, Brian Eno and Peter Schmidt created this deck of cards filled with prompts to basically help musicians and artists overcome creative blocks by providing something to work with, a starting point. It can be an arbitrary prompt that you can either follow or push against. But it does provide a starting point for you to like kind of break out of your dull cycles of making and thinking. So I decided that I would pull a card from this deck. I didn't actually. I had a Chrome extension downloaded where every time I opened a new tab, it gave me a card. And I decided to work with the letter A because it's got so much potential. It's got the straight part, the curved part, bowl. It can have a tail. It can even have a ball terminal if you wanted to up top. It can be single story, double story. So let me share with you some of these. Faced with a choice, do both. So this one is, if you look closely, it's both an uppercase A and a lowercase a. Abandon normal instruments. So here I was using just some special characters and a punctuation to construct the letter A. Use an old idea, so I went back to the old idea that is calligraphy. You can only make one dot at a time. I think that one's pretty self-explanatory. Emphasize repetitions. So I'm using the same arc module over and over again. Do we need holes? Apparently we don't. Twist a spine, quite literal. Make it more sensual. That's what I'm not gonna explain. Imagine the music as a moving chain or a caterpillar. That's what I came up with. Courage. So I wondered if I integrated an exclamation point into the letter form itself, does it make the A more courageous? Back up a few steps. What else could you have done? So I backed up a few steps and looked at this. And I decided to put the exclamation point right inside in the white form, in this case, black form. So I've been posting on my column on this design blog called type.center /KR for Korean. It is written in Korean. And then kind of like explain my thinking behind each one. And I haven't run out of cards yet, so this is an ongoing series. It's possible that I am the only Korean speaker here, I think. I anticipated this, which is why I have the Hangul next to the moments that I want you to look for in this next video that I'm going to show. So more than ever before, I think I'm appreciating my Korean roots because I'm a type designer, and looking at Hangul, the Korean alphabet, I am just constantly being amazed by it for both its beautiful form, its versatility, and also its elegance in logic. That's a whole another topic. But this is a video that I created for my minimalist mother, who's taken up minimalist living and did not want anything in her house for her birthday. Anybody's birthday here soon? Who? Okay. Happy. So, okay. Well, this is for my mom, but it can be for other people also. So, this is this is ma, which means mom. Sa rang hey, which means I love you. And I wanted I wanted to show you because although it's like so quickly done and personal and casual, because it represents the kind of creative type I am and the kind of person that I am. I am really interested in using the everyday objects in my practice. So here we go. Thank you.